I've been working with leaders or aspiring leaders, people who want to be in a leadership position, mainly wanting to climb the corporate ladder as part of their career. And it really made me think about, careers. What is that? What is that idea of wanting and needing to have a career when you really, because a lot of these people I talk to, they don't really know why, if you really ask them. I mean, the reason could be you're making more money, growing into a position that is more fun and makes you more happy. And happiness can be connected to prestige, to being proud of what you do and being the boss, and I don't know, with something like that. Sure. Image. Sure. But the more people I speak to, the more I hear sort of the doubt that people have when they also realize that if you career means often that you get disconnected from the things that you actually want to do. So you really get into politics the higher you climb that ladder. And unless you really like that, unless you are kind of that kind of person that likes the politics of business, it's really not going to make you happy. And so I've been talking to people about this idea of horizontal growth or lateral growth, this idea of carving out a position that is uniquely yours. And in one way or another, I don't know, to me it makes total sense, but specifically to people who are in large organizations, big corporates, to them that's like that's the weirdest thought ever. Like, can you just kind of create your own position, carve out your own space to be you, and don't you just have to kind of, fit into a specific profile that's there, the job descriptions that are out there? Shouldn't you kind of try to kind of fit yourself into these boxes? Anyway, it's a thought I keep having when I speak to people who are looking to have a career in a larger organization, but I see them doubting whether they're going to be happy when they need to go into politics, basically. So I'll leave that with you. The only thing I might really want to add is that, yes, you can and you should think about what makes you happy and what fits with your purpose, and think about long term and how happy you're going to be in a specific position, because that will affect everything you do. Okay. I'd like to mention one other thing. On October the 8th, the Design Thinking Conference is going to run an online experiment. So for those who are interested in seeing how we are going to change the future of the conference, because a conference, I mean, seriously, you cannot translate your conference one-on-one. Like, you can't just put your offline content on video conferencing channels. You cannot just copy-paste it. It doesn't work. We have to really start reinventing the conference, and it's something we've been doing at the Design Thinking Conference anyway. So we took it upon ourselves to question the online conference. There's a first experiment, October the 8th, and everything is going to kick off in January. And we're going to have an offline physical event and probably somewhere in spring. We're not sure about the date. Depends a little bit on the COVID-19 situation. But I'll keep you posted. So, www.designthinkingconference.com. Designthinkingconference.com. You'll find more information. Okay, so today I talk to Ralf Beuker. It's a special guest because I've known Ralf for a very, very long time. Basically, just after the birth of design thinking, when I started my company, and Ralf had been very active within design management. So we're going to talk about design management. Now, Ralf is the dean of the design faculty at the University of Applied Science in Muenster in Germany. He's also a professor of design management. And we're going to talk about the evolution of design management and design thinking and how I pissed him off. We're also going to talk about the positive sides and negative sides of humor, of making jokes, and why. We're going to talk about the transitions from chaos to patterns and back again, reflecting, critical thinking, and how sometimes you can be totally blind to change and too stuck in routines. So comedy, actually, you know, making jokes, humor is a big topic, as you will hear. And I thought it would be a great place to also mention a book that I have always found very inspirational. It's called The Comic Toolbox, How to Be Funny, Even If You're Not. It's written by John Forhaus, a good friend of mine, and it's a really, really inspirational book. John and I have been on this show before. Check out the book, connect to John. It is really a wonderful toolbox. Anyway, here I am talking to Ralf Beuker. Enjoy.
In general, I'm quite curious. I like making jokes all the time, but I think that is a mixture between an escape out of uncomfortable situations. But by the same token, I even if I make bad jokes, they are most related to me, but sometimes people don't get it. So there's a subtle kind of humor, but depending on the audience or the other person in front of me, they might consider it as really dull jokes, and others don't get it. So interestingly, my partner and I, we can laugh about a lot of things, but in some specific areas, we have totally different views on humor. But I would describe myself mainly on that, and that people might like that, and there are quite a few people who think I'm silly.
Is that something you care about?
Yeah, now you get the podcast answer. No. I learned to how emancipate myself from that. And during school time, high school, that was something that triggered me, but it facilitated my whole career, this discrepancy. No, yeah, yes, for sure. I mean, to be honest, it makes you vulnerable to a certain degree, because people can criticize you for that, and humor is something that is very individual to people, to cultures, to countries, and the likes. So
yeah, so
And you know, we know each other, you know, for a very long time. We know each other. We've known each other for a very long time.
Okay.
Now.
And, until that podcast.
Yeah. And I, humor is a, to me, humor is a, is something that connects me to people. And if I think about the people that I like to spend time with, these are the people I like to, you know, joke with and laugh with, and have, because that's a specific connection I have to some people, and it's a connection I think we had when we met each other, that it was through humor and understanding sometimes the odd jokes, the weird jokes, the that maybe made some people frown. And other people are like, what's that all about? That's really silly. But it's an interesting topic, really, because for me, humor has always been a way to connect to people. So also when I facilitate, you know, creative sessions, I do keynote at a conference, for instance, I use humor to kind of, as a little bit of a probe, to throw a little probe into the audience or into the group to see if I get any response. And if people are not laughing, to me, that's a sign of, oh, there's a disconnect or something going on. And if people are laughing, I got them, right? There's a connection. But it makes you vulnerable, like you were saying. And I also know you as someone who's actually really worried about that on a specific level. Yeah. On a specific level. Yeah. Here's the thing where when you interview someone, you know, really well, that you know, no lying to me, man. No, but seriously, I mean, there's this, I feel that I have the same. I want to be myself. I want to make silly jokes. And if you let me go, I'll make too many jokes and I can't be serious. And then I'm in the serious meeting and I'm thinking, can I make a joke here? But if I can't make a joke, actually it means that I'm in a situation that I really am not comfortable in. But if I can make a joke, and if I'm allowed to make a joke and I make people laugh, it diffuses the moment, and it's an icebreaker, it is a connector, it is wonderful. But at the same time, I'm interested about what you're saying, because it's interesting because you describe yourself with saying, it's actually, you talked about humor, which is so important to you, but at the same time, it kind of divides the room, if you will, right?
Certainly, yeah.
Why do you keep doing that?
You sound like my mother. You sound like my mother. I mean, why are you keep doing that?
Why do you keep doing that?
Sorry.
Man? Yeah. Sorry. Well, no, if you care so much about the effect on some people, so why do you keep making, because I also know that you're unstoppable. You are totally unstoppable. If you're in front of an audience, you will make the jokes, even though you're not sure if they like it. Even though you know probably some people won't like it. There will be a lot of people who will not, who will shy away from that. They say, I'm not going to. No. And so it's something I like about you, because you are out there. You are vulnerable. You know some people are not going to like that. But at the same time, I'm also worried about you. So I have been, you know, somewhere in a room and thinking, I think Ralph, some people don't like this joke, but you're making it, but I like it. So it's okay. So I'm fine with it, but you know what I'm saying? So why?
Yeah, that's the German approach to it. We are not liked everywhere in Europe, but we don't care. You see, we just go for it.
That's not true. Tell me the truth. You do care.
Sure. I have to recapitulate what the question actually was. You were asking, that was the mother question. Why I keep doing that? Oh, Jesus, you trigger so much fantasy in my head. I could have immediately responded to you. Okay, I will tell you afterwards at the off-track side of the podcast. Actually, as I said, it helps to, and I think you wanted me also talk a bit serious, so we can slowly fade into that leadership part that you're interested in. Actually, it as I said earlier, it helps me to find an escape path out of uncomfortable situations. So it's, even though I know it can maybe sometimes offend people, irritate people, annoy people. It's in the end, it's my mechanism to bring me into a situation again where I feel, where at least I feel comfortable. And to be honest, I if you would have asked me that question 10 years ago, I would not have said that I use it deliberately. And I think I've sophisticated in hyphens, that technique, or to use that thing to my advantage, because as you correctly said, it's not always an advantage. And there are situations where humor is not the thing to go, or where you have to use it in a very subtle way. You have to scan the room. You have to sense the people, how they are, what kind of characters they are. And as you also said, if I'm in a situation where it's really serious, then it really always comes up and I have to stop it. And that makes me, then I don't have control over the situation, but then I have a hard time controlling myself. So then I'm on a double layer mode where I have to regulate myself. I would know how to regulate, but that's the trick I can't apply.
Exactly. And it's a tension that you want to, somewhere in your mind, you want to diffuse it. You want to make it, you know, so there's all these jokes that come up, but at the same time, you can't, you're like, so as an example, I was the other day, I was in a conversation about preparing for a launch of a project for coaching people, coaching leaders. And one of the things we want to teach them is create a psychological safe space and to bring their authentic self to really be themselves. And so we were preparing the lunch, and the people who were preparing the lunch and were briefing us, they were very serious about that. It has to be perfect, 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 on time, on time, on time. And, you know, spot on. It has to be platinum. It has to be to the second, you know, it's scripted. And so this is the conversation where my brain goes, can I now make a joke about, tell them, and can I do this with a joke? And so you feel really uncomfortable because there is a paradox somewhere. I think that's, those situations are sometimes not the situations you make jokes, but it is difficult to kind of keep yourself from making jokes, or because you know they're not going to understand it, so you have to find another route. So that kind of situations I feel that humor sometimes can be a disadvantage if that's a sort of something you're inclined to do. And I'm really, like yourself, I'm inclined to do so. But is that something you did as a child? Is that something you did like when you were a kid?
Yeah. And now it goes really to the Freudian route, into family psychology and the like. No, I think I've learned that a bit from my mother.
Because where did you grow up?
In Dutch, I would say vlak bij de grens, which translates to close to the German-Dutch border, in North Rhine-Westphalia, in the northwestern part of it. It's 1 hour's car drive from Düsseldorf, Cologne, in that area. It's north from the Ruhrgebiet for the other listeners. But as you told me, there are a lot of Germans listening to this. And so they would know the city of Münster, where this is. But I grew up in Aus, a very small area, or very small town, 25,000 people living there, and so very traditional, conservative, Christian structures. with not with strict rules, but with clear rules. It's this. It's an area where the Catholic Church can determine a lot, and I've been influenced by that. So I've been raised in a very traditional Catholic way in a authoritative context. So my parents, I was really loved by my parents. So just to keep that in brackets, but in a very authoritative way. So if my dad said something, I was sitting upright. So a bit of this command and order. So if I got an assignment, I had to do it. But on the other way, there it was not that strict, like as you might imagine that in a movie. But that's where I grew up, and that's how I was raised. And having said that might come from my mother. It's also a way to make yourself appealing to others. So I think on a subtle layer, you do that.
The jokes, not all, sense of humor, yeah, and making jokes. Yeah, so when you were growing up as a child, that is also something you used. But yes, did you do it? Do it consciously, or was it something that you now, in hindsight, say, "Oh yeah, I guess I used." I mean, were you the boy that everybody, you're like the center of attention and making the jokes, and everybody knew you as the funny guy, or what kind of kid were you?
To be honest, but that's now. But anyway, so it's a conversation between you and me, and you promised me to never send this podcast live, so I can share these things with you.
No one will ever hear this.
Okay, that's good. No, actually, I learned that on a very, so your first question was consciously or unconsciously. Mm-hmm. No, it was completely unconscious. Mm-hmm. And one day you discover as a kid, I think that's a psychologist would call that a normal development curve. You discover when you, I don't know, when you splash the spoon of soup into your face, then the adults laugh. Funny kid. And when you learn that mechanism, you try to start experimenting unconsciously with it. And if you see it hits, like, oh, they are laughing, and that makes you appear sweet and what a cute boy or whatever, then I think it gets a self dynamic into that. Actually, you asked me about how I was as a kid. I would have considered myself, school was horror, because I felt not accepted at all. So I felt, I think, to be honest, I don't know, but that is in hindsight now my reflection on it. I think the other kids did not like me too much. And then I developed that I think I was a bit, for my teachers, so they might forgive me, I was a bit of the clown in the class, in the classroom. And oh my God, the psychologist might really exploit that podcast now. And I think even though it was a mechanism to make myself appealing, and even though, and that goes back to the question, why didn't you stop? I recognize that even I think at school, even my other fellow students, they didn't like my jokes, but I went on for it. And in that way, it was developing sometimes, and now it gets very dramatic how I describe it, a self-fulfilling prophecy. So I had in mind, if I do now a joke, that might, the little chances there that it might make me appealing to others, but then my fatal me said, Ralf, that will never land that joke. And the other side said, oh, I don't care, but there's the chance of 1%. So I made it. Then people, oh my God, Ralf again. And then I said, yeah, you see, Ralf. So the one side of Ralf said to the other side of Ralf, you see, I promised you that will not land. And then I said, yeah, Yeah, so everything is fine. So the ecosystem worked. It was predictable. There was a little chance of success.
Right.
And then it gets a dynamic to it. But then comes a point, and while we are at deep character studies, on the other side, I was I think I was quite good in sports. So I used to be a swimmer, and I was quite successful with it. And to be honest, that I think that compensated for it, because then I know if I jump into the pool and prepare for the next competition, I knew that I was able to beat them all. So and that gave me a compensation for that other side of my life, which for young students, school is actually. And then you learn to compensate for that. And the very moment I was able to, I escaped from that social space in my hometown. So I left my town when I was 19, and I return from once in a while because my parents still live there, but I'm always happy when I can leave that space. Even though there are a lot of nice memories connected to it. So and the Netherlands are part of it. So
Tom, I want to go back just so bear with me. Go back to, because you said something about
Yeah, you have to stop me because otherwise, you know.
Yeah. Well, it's a I'll share an observation in a moment, but I still have a question about what you said about, well, it's probably from my mother. And I that may be kind of curious, because as a child, when you were at school, primary school, I guess, you were both a clown, but also I'll share my observation. Okay, so I will ask my question after I share my observation, because what you're describing, so the humor you have, and as a the diffusion of tension, of keeping control of the situation, etc. In this conversation, it will probably also be observed by the listeners, is that you go back and forth. You can go from serious to making jokes, or sometimes you start with a little joke and then you go into the serious part. You switch really quickly. As a listener and someone who is interviewing you at the moment, I never know where you're going. Are you going to go serious? Or are you going to go to the joke part? Or are you going from the joke to the serious part, or the other way around? But there will always be a mix of these two things. So you'll say something serious and then you go like make a funny joke or something else, or to kind of make it lighthearted, or make a observational comment about this, like, oh, you know, now the psychiatrist or the psychologist will kind of really, you know, like the list, et cetera, et cetera. So, you do that. That's a constant. Which is something that I very much connect to, but I can also imagine that it can be, you know, exactly
stressful for other people.
Yeah, because they don't know where you're going, and you're like, oh, he's serious, not serious, serious, not serious, serious, not serious. He's making fun of himself. Also, you're making fun of yourself all the time.
Yeah, sure.
Right.
Yeah,
so, which is also, it's really interesting, because we're talking about it. While we're talking about it, you're doing it. Is my observation.
It's Inception-esque from the movie.
But my question was about, you know, you kind of touched on, it probably comes from my mother, and I kind of want to ask you, because it's not something every child will kind of have or will go through, this idea of this paradox of being funny, making jokes, but at the same time feeling very disconnected from the other children. And how is your mother a part of that?
I think so. My mother also learned she's a child of the post-World War years, Second World War, not first, right? So I'm not that old. Got me. She's a child of the Second World War after, or that post-World War phase, and And she even grew up in an even more conservative part and fashion and manner. And for her, it was clearly the way she got her likes in that social economy currency world. She gets her likes from being on stage, making these amateur theater thing and the like. So that where she got, I think, a lot of her self-esteem from. Because if she was raised up like women were developing in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, like only a minor education. Then you work as a housewife, raise the kids, and even considering having a half-time job after the kids leave the house is something that was quite debatable. So that was her way to connect, also to connect to the outside, to have something that she can be proud of, and at least for I have to be careful what I say, at least for her kind of humor, her kind of audience, her kind of amateur theater roles and plays, that was the thing she drew, or she took her self-esteem from. And a bit from, I think, when you are a kid, say from the age until, I don't know, 10, you unconsciously observe your parents, you take over certain things, and then the big challenge is to emancipate yourself from that and develop as a individual character. Mm-hmm. But I think it has not always been that the case. So that I discovered myself as someone playing with humor. So I think, I mean, for me, the 90s were a phase of where I got lost to lots of the world. So techno music was not something that interested me. So the 90s were, it's a decade that lost me. And if you would ask me now, was that something important for you? I think that during that phase, that was nothing of any importance. I cannot remember situations where that had any importance, or where that brought me forward, or whatever.
So what were you doing in the 90s?
Dressing very awkwardly, looking much older than I was.
Right.
What?
Is that when, so wait, wait, you were, so you went, yeah. When you were 19, you went from home, you started, yeah. What did you start studying? Because that might explain something.
That answer makes me much older than people might think I am. So I went to the army. I had to. That right. was obligate. That was compulsory. Sorry, not obligatory. Compulsory. At that time, so I had to join the army for 2 years, like that was usual in many European countries. And after that, I started. Officially, I started studying. Unofficially, I started partying to compensate for the 2 years at the army. And I studied business administration, but simply because, and that's also maybe it contributes to that part, to this podcast or not. You wanted to ask me, why did you study business administration? Now you have to check your list.
It is relevant.
Okay.
So, but I wasn't.
Not now.
Well, sure. If you wanted to talk about that now, that's great. Because I do wonder. No, I want to understand. I want to understand your journey. And I want to understand why you made the decisions that you made. I mean, you could have mm-hmm. chosen. I mean, if you would have told me the stories and I would have not have known the rest of the story, then people would say, so You know, you heard Ralf talk a little bit about his childhood and a little bit about his mother. I haven't heard anything about his father yet, but maybe we'll get through there. What do you think he became later when he grew up? What is his profession? That's the quiz. I might have guessed a stand-up comedian or something like that. Or he went into, he's doing all these comedies now, or, right? No, but he's on stage, that's what he's doing. So, yeah. but then, of course, and you had to go because mandatory, you went to the army 2 years. Did you do anything interesting during the army times? I mean, where were you? You were in the Netherlands, right?
Yes, I was in the Netherlands.
Yeah.
I did you do something interesting? Let me think. No.
All right. Skip that. All right. No. All right. After two years of army, then you went to study.
Yeah.
You were going to do business administration.
Yes. Yeah.
Why?
And
so here's the question. And here's the question. Why? Okay.
Thank you. Finally, you asked for that. I have to unfold my scripted answer now. And that also goes back to childhood. So that's this podcast. It has got the overarching theme of leadership and what makes you leader to whatever. So childhood and humor seems to be two components. Actually, when I was, 12, 13, something like that. I discovered, so my parents didn't read the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. That's something you read in Germany, which has got a very, very good image, intellectual daily paper, newspaper. And I don't know, for some strange reasons, on Saturdays, the Saturday edition was very thick. Really thick. You get a lot of paper for money, and I bought that edition, and then I flipped through it. I skim read it. Then I discovered that huge part of that Saturday edition of that paper is jobs offers, because the internet was not present in the 80s or late 70s. So you had, 5 centimeters of jobs that companies were offering. And I was flipping through, so cleaning and facility management, which was not facility management at that time, was something that didn't click with me. And also that all the jobs that work with their hands, I skipped all that parts, and then I landed mentally in that big world, in that big part of business world. And then I saw an advertisement like, we're looking for the head of foreign exports, or the head of management, the head of human resources management for, I don't know, for Volkswagen. Whatever. So companies that, as a 13-year-old, you have heard in the news, but you have no idea in general what they are up to. So I saw these job advertisements and I read through. And at that time, the companies were making job descriptions, what you should give and what they give. And I found that very appealing, especially salaries. So at that time, so I learned that you can earn a lot of money when you are the head of export for whatever medium-sized company, or starting with medium-sized company. And your responsibilities, you are responsible for a large team of people. You develop strategies about future development paths for that division and the like. So, and I thought, wow, that is something that was really appealing. That clicked to me. And then I decided I want to become an export manager. So if the neighbor, and I remember, I think we my parents had some really funny neighbors. They asked me, or grandparents ask you, so what do you want to become? And I said, I want to become an export manager.
Seriously?
Or let it be the head of human resources, whatever. So I gave answers like that, not to entertain other people, but I meant it seriously. And then that was the neighbor I didn't like, asked me, so do you already know how to do that? And I mean, then for a 13-year-old, I said, no. but that means you have to make a good A-level exam at school, and then you need to study, and then you need to do internships and the likes. And I thought, oh, Jesus, okay. So there was no direct path from school to become the head of human resources. And then I discovered, and then I saw in the very small printed, you have to study, you have an excellent degree in business administration. So I thought, okay. And luckily enough, there was no numerus clausus. Is that something one says? So there was no limit. So you didn't need to have a minimum grade to subscribe to that study program, which worked to my advantage at that time. So
because you weren't performing well at school, or you?
No. I was average. Look at me. I'm average. I was average. I was good, but not. Specifically, and my majors at school were English and French. So I have my brain goes more for the languages than for the natural sciences. So with language, when you make an A-level exam in languages, there's always a teacher who sees a bias or. It was good. It was good enough. And then I studied business administration. And I found that university program quite nice. We have to beam ourselves back to the 80s, where international cooperations between universities across Europe was not on the top list of topics that universities were interested in. So that university, which was really in a very Catholic odd land, part of in Germany, far enough from home that prevented me to go home every weekend. So I had to stay there, and there I developed my social and student life there. So yeah, I studied business administration, which was far less charming and interesting than I thought. So it was a lot of mathematics and statistics and numbers crunching. So then again, I went for the more, what outsiders would call the soft topics, like organization decision finding, psychology of groups, and that was feeding the marketing part. Then human resources management, that was more the stream I was following. And then I made an, I think, good, but not super good exam. So in the end, which then qualified me that I was at least qualified for doing a PhD. And that was something. And at that age, I was, I don't know, in the mid of my 20s. And this now goes real old man talks now. For the younger listeners of your podcast, and you told me 95% of our 20, 21 of your listeners.
Tell them, Grandpa.
Exactly.
In your 20s. Yeah.
In my 20s, previous century. I thought it would give me some more security to stay still a bit at university, because that was the system I learned, and that's the other side of me, that I'm if I discovered something that works for me, I'm quite sticky with that. So with routines and maybe success recipes, And there you slowly see we go back, we discover back that topic. So so humor, I think now in hindsight, to look back to my, what other might call career, humor is maybe one ingredient, and the other is routines. And by the same token, with humor, a routine can give you really stability, and it helps you to filter the noise and to remain stable in a very unstable context. But at the other side, it can make you a bit narrow-minded. It can make you what in German is called spießig, which is to point always at, this is the routine things have to go through. Mm-hmm. And when you become older and also as a leader, if you emphasize too much on that, and that is what my current job has taught me is constantly remind yourself that a routine is fine, but always be a bit critical and ask yourself, is this routine still valid? Is it really giving me the outcome, the output that is not only good for me, but also good for the people I work with?
But that means you have to be aware of those routines, and routines can be habits, can be patterns.
Yes.
So it's not always easy to actually be aware of those routines. Mm. Or to recognize them as routines that you might be able to change, or be explicit about the meaning of the routine or the value of the routine for yourself, and for others, which is even a step beyond recognizing it for yourself. Mm. So I think that if you think about leadership, then it means that you also have to be aware of, you know, what's going on in yourself, that then you kind of, you know, that creates a connection to others, and that also creates patterns and routines for others and your teams and the people you work for. So that's a big influence. But I'm staying a little bit because you were still at your 20s, because you were you're doing your you had the grades to do a PhD. You then but you stayed at university. What did you do?
I was working something like a teaching assistant, or a junior lecturer, something like that. Mm-hmm. But that at that time it was in economics. Mm. I worked for a professor who was teaching economics, and I worked because that was an open job that university offered, and so it was not the topic that really interested me, but I could deliver the outcomes that were expected from me, and then there was this interim professor, that American guy. He was lecturing management of innovation and technology. So that was in the mid 90s. That was something that was very hip, and especially in Germany, there weren't too many universities. I think it was the second professorship in Germany, second or third, that was nominated to that topic. And that professor who got his professorship. So, by the way, Michael Dowling is his name. He deserves the credit, clearly. he asked me, so do you want to come with me to Regensburg? And we set up this new chair for management of innovation and technology. So I went there and I started working there. I had a sense of technology and fascination for technological development. So I'm a gadget guy, same as you are. So we are into gadgets, Arne and me, like many other, some call it a man's phenomenon. But anyway, so I was always interested in these things. And the internet in 1992, 93 was something that was really fascinating me. And the internet at that time was only present in universities, so you could experiment around with it very nicely in a university context and the like. So, and I had some nerd reputation about that Ralf is the guy who is in dangerous knowledge of that internet. He's not knowing what he's doing actually there, but he knows how to do it. And so I discovered the internet, these gopher services, FTP news and all that kind of stuff. So I was really not aware what I was doing, but I succeeded. So I learned all about this internet thingy. And that, in a way, I think, next to my formal qualification, qualified me to be asked for that other job there in Bavaria, down in Regensburg. And to do research into what this thingy called internet might mean for business, and might mean for business processes, might mean for the acceleration of technological development cycles, not one in itself as internet as a technology, but also the internet as a facilitator for other processes. And that I found quite very challenging, interesting, and that professor was really that providing the best setup that I could have imagined. But at the same time, and that goes now to the human side, I felt very homesick. And there we go again to that what I've just said 5 minutes ago, to be a routine person. I think from a larger sense, from a routine perspective, maybe stick to a certain region, to a piece of land, to a piece of culture, very regional culture, is something that is also in a larger sense a routine. It's a stability, and I very much tended to I'm a candidate for being homesick. And I felt really, in hindsight, I felt seriously homesick. So I wanted to, and in hindsight, I think the very first day I moved there, I knew I want to go away from this place, even though it provided me so many options and the like. So 3 years there were a constant pendulum between leaving, staying. And I don't want to talk about the torture that is too dramatic, but in hindsight, I see now that it was that it didn't let me exploit my fullest capabilities. It was always something that was dragging me into zones where I couldn't fully exploit what I was able to deliver. And so I left that university after that contract ran out. And the initial idea is that after these 3 years, you complete your PhD. And so I had to admit, at that time I didn't do it, but I had to admit, it came later on, that I didn't succeed in that part. So I didn't, I wasn't able to deliver that PhD in that period of time. So I said, okay, I will do it as an extern. And make myself self-employed. So I started working working as a self-employed consultant. But in between was that one conference. I was just about to leave that job, that 3 years contract, and I went to a design conference, and that was end of the 90s, in the very early 2000s. Where the first internet hype really started, where web page design was paid by the page. So if you made a website with 10 pages, you were able to earn 10,000 euros, something like that. That those were the days, the old man's talk. Close now. And at a conference, and that's the advice for the younger listeners, I was asked, so what are you up to? And I said, yeah, wow, this internet thing. And like, oh, you know about this internet thing? Yeah, we need someone in our, it was quite big design consultancy in Frankfurt. And yeah, we that's an area, digital design, we want to develop. So you are in the know. I will make you senior consultant because I was 30 at that time, or 29, something like that. They said, yeah, okay, you must be senior. You worked, you are writing your doctoral thesis. So you get a team. At least that was my impression, that I got a team. Officially, I got a team, but they never knew that they were part of my team. So anyway, but I believe that I had a team, that we were a team of three. And we now developed for that design consultancy the digital business. It was more or less, it was what is nowadays called the supply chain management facilitated by the internet. So we wanted to set up a service design strategy enabled by digital technologies. But that was far too earlier at that time. So yeah, I worked there for more than 1 year as a consultant, and then I discovered that I want to be more independent. And parallel to that, was also a part where design management programs popped up all over the world, and through a very nice, mainly it started in the Netherlands. So my network has always been very Dutch. Due to the fact that I simply love your country. I don't want to live in the Netherlands. Seriously, that's what also one thing I discovered, that because that would be too chaotic for me. So talking about routine. I make a lot of jokes about Germans and therefore about myself. But I discovered that in the end I'm German. I'm laughing about myself, but and then sometimes you Dutch are. You Dutch as such, like the Japanese. No, you Dutch are a bit too chaotic for me. You are very innovative as a society and also economically. You are very innovative, far more innovative than the Germans are. But sometimes that's too much stress for me. So and then I drive back 2 hours to Germany, and then I'm in safe haven again. And when I have enough from German stability and engineering and 90 degrees angles, then I go back. So I started also lecturing for design management degree programs, postgraduate degree programs. And from some of these contacts, I got assignments, business assignments. To consult some companies in more or less developing or supporting them, these people, mostly designers or people responsible for design within larger corporations, right, to find a better language between the board of directors and the design department.
So is this when you became interested in design? Because this is the first time in the story the word design pops up.
Yeah, you're right.
So how did because from if you listen to your story, first of all, you think he's going to be a comedian, then mm-hmm. you think, oh no, he's going to be a export manager.
yeah.
But then you're all into innovation and the internet a little bit by chance, but you mm-hmm. But then all of a sudden design. Here comes design. How?
Yeah. That missing puzzle. Okay, that's something. Because I think it's more. I came to design by my first wife. So my first wife, she still is. I now spent all the jokes that I do at lectures. Maybe you should cut that out, something like that. So then I'm not funny anymore. If now listeners who might be prospective participants in a design thinking bootcamp, something like that. And they hear the jokes. They say, oh, look, he's always doing the same jokes, like you. Then the audience sits there like you always sit there, rolling your eyes and saying, oh, no, Ralf, not that joke again. But anyway, I make a fireworks now of my, what I consider best jokes. Anyways, no, she's still alive. She's a graphic designer. So I studied business administration and management, and she studied design, and design plus management makes design management. And I don't know, coincidence at that time, design management was hyped, not all over the place, but I think not that much as design thinking used to, but I think it was a bit the predecessor of, I think we were looking for that term design thinking at those days, but we labeled it design management because maybe those days were more serious, a bit less creative, a bit more, yeah, the early 2000s.
I mean, you might be able to consider that part of an evolution, right? An evolutionary process where you have to speak the language that is being used and which is comfortable and not too scary. But by adding design to management, I think at that time, that was pretty revolutionary for a lot of people. Like, just because these two worlds, you know, before that really never met.
No. Right? Design was something from the 90s, like in Mad Men. Mad Men transferred to the 90s. That was what design was about at design departments. And for management, design was pure decoration. And exactly. and advertising design was more or less part of advertising,
but you were interested. It drew your attention.
Yeah.
Partly because of your first wife. Mm-hmm.
A lot of intrinsic factors like internet, like export manager. Mm-hmm. That a lot of things emerged really from an intrinsic trigger. That transformed into something.
But it is also the what you do with it. So yes, of course, but it's still that not everyone who has a wife who is a designer is, you know, turns into a design manager.
No.
It's just you. It's mainly you. But it's what you do with what happens to you and how you translate that and how you mold that into something. It triggered you. It was presented to you and you said, hey, that is interesting. And it may be part of your character, that the paradox of your character, which almost is your relationship with Germany and the Netherlands. It's almost symbolic of who you are. You love the chaos. You like to be disrupt. Your the jokes you make are always a little bit disruptive. They are meant to disrupt. You don't. Mm-hmm. You are about, you know, disrupting patterns, even though people might not like you for it. But you can't just let it go. So that, which is actually causing some chaos, like specifically the start of this interview, you could feel sort of the chaotic kind of way of speaking and telling stories. But at the same time, you like routines. You like to be home. You're running every morning, right? You have this amazing routine that you will never stop for anyone or anything, right? Which is there's a big divide between these two kind of worlds. Of very being very strict to yourself as well, and very strict about yourself and what you're supposed to do and how you're supposed to do things, and at the same time really loving chaos and just wandering around and making jokes and having conversations that go nowhere and doesn't matter, and right, so it's the paradox. So design sort of and management in a way is that. It's those two worlds.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Like you, thank you, Arne. You framed it very nicely. No, you're absolutely right. I haven't considered it. Maybe, to be honest, maybe that was one of the incentives for, we can reveal that. I mean, we're friends. I mean, and doing this podcast as a friend with you is beside being friends and an honor. But I was also thinking what might come out, what might be the reward, not the reward, the payoff of this podcast for me, beside giving something to you, and this insight of and the obvious it might look now, but I've never considered it that way, that it might be part of the pattern. So I think that's the nice thing of reflecting while you go, that these connections and the connecting dots pop up.
Yeah, because you need people when you know things change and you know the world changes, technology changes, business changes, everything changes. You need people to be able to create these bridges, you know, to have you know our economies, our societies, and what you know whatever level you talk, you know, to allow that to kind of go to the other side, you know, or connect those dots. And so, you know, and if I think about leadership, to me, leadership is all about understanding patterns, seeing patterns, and being able to connect things that are not connected, which is also design. You connect things that aren't previously connected or badly connected, and you see patterns. So this is a pattern that was there. And in a way, although you didn't know that before, it had a language, but you were already there. You were already in, you know, you were already, you know, exploring new things in the internet, and you were interested in it. It was intrinsically motivated. Nobody told you to discover internet and to look at it and to be interested in it, but you were. And at the same time, you know, you came from a world that was very, you know, organized, and it was about management, and it was et cetera, et cetera. So
yeah,
I think it is where people start emerging that are comfortable in that kind of transition moments. So the moment of transition, you know, was your moment, I think, where you came like, hey, I'm comfortable here, where a lot of people were not comfortable. And there were a lot of people who thought it wasn't far enough, it should be more extreme. And they were out there, and you were right there in the middle. And I think that, is this the time you started your blog as well?
Yeah. That was, I think, in 2003. I started that was the first old man's comment now, first wave of blogs where again, it was a random thing. It was only because I was able to set it up technically. So I was fiddling around with the predecessor of WordPress, I think Movable Type, something like that. That was a software. It was free. It was very beta. It was version 0.4.6.3, something like that. And suddenly I was able to type in, like in a text editor, hello world. I pressed publish, and then it appeared on a web server under web address. And I was totally fascinated. And that was really a 2:35 hours in the night or morning moment where, oh, okay, I have a domain design-management.de.com was already blocked. And I had the technology. And then I thought, okay, shit, I have to do something with it now. So I started blogging about design management and my random observations and reflections. And I did that, I think, for 5 or 6 years. Mm-hmm. And now it's technically completely corrupt. It disappeared. No, the domain is still online, but it gives you a WordPress error message. And mm-hmm. I But there was a time where I thought, no, this is enough, and I had serious things to do, you know. So, but interestingly talking about patterns at that time, my interesting observation was, blogging during those days gave you, not so many claps on your shoulders. So I had quite a lot of readers after 1 or 2 years. And I think 1,000 regular readers at that time was quite nice. But the interesting thing is that from my very personal network, people got offended. Other consultants got offended. And especially one person that I not officially broke up with, I don't mention names now, maybe you know who I'm talking about, and he was so offended by it. Ralf, you're giving away knowledge for free, and you disrupt our business because other people need to sell these consulting and coaching insights to companies, and you give them away for free on your website and the like. So I was thinking, oh, that's an interesting perspective.
I recognize that. I recognize it which I thought was extremely valuable and eye-opening. And I really love the fact that at that time, people started emerging, also agencies started emerging that actually gave away their models and their way of working and their philosophies. So now you can't imagine anymore that was a weird thing to do. But at that time, no agency would disclose their processes and their models and the way they worked. No, but isn't it odd now in hindsight that you're thinking, now we're all, you know, we're all, that's the thing to do. Like, I have a framework. Here's my framework. So now it's actually, it's the opposite. Now you're saying, get away with your stupid frameworks. Yeah. You know, it's almost the opposite. You know, don't.
Have you seen the triple diamond, by the way? There's not the double diamond. There's the triple diamond model. Seriously.
All right. That's another podcast.
So now you think, oh, Jesus Christ, it's going into models.
I'm interested in models. I'm interested in frameworks. I'm interested in the reason why they were at that time where you're talking about, we did not share our models. We had the doors closed. And all of a sudden, there were people and agencies, and I'm kind of proud to have been part of that movement, who have said, and this is where I think also we started connecting, because we were starting to talk openly about how to do things, what were the secret recipes basically of how to do, how we think these creative processes would work, et cetera.
So, but you also got a little bit on my nerves. You remembered that, and talking about. But sorry to interrupt you. That's usually not my style. you remember that, because I have talked about these routines that help you. And I talked about this German word spießig. That means if you stick too much to routines. And interestingly, attention, advice to the younger listeners, really always try to be critical, because you also, in hindsight, in that very moment you pissed me off, but in hindsight you showed me that I was slowly becoming the little, very little asshole that I never wanted to become. So business advice: never become the asshole you never wanted to be.
Why did I piss you off?
No, interestingly, you see, it was where talking about these curves, these life cycles. Mm-hmm. So design management at that time was on, I don't know, the early downswing. Mm-hmm. And then design thinkers came up. A dude on Twitter, so Twitter those days, Twitter was really new. A dude on Twitter was twittering about design thinking. First you reserved the Twitter name Design Thinkers for you, and you made these statements about, I don't know, design thinking is the glue between whatever. No, I think that emerged later. But anyways, so I was reading it. I was thinking, geez, what is that? Is that now the disruption here of the industry or what? Who is he? And then I discovered that you were pretty relaxed. At that time, I thought arrogant. And you were the arrogant dude from Amsterdam, and now ignoring all the honors that personally I have thought I have received through the community. And now he's talking about something completely different, not completely different. I considered it as completely different, but that didn't connect, but that had the word design in it. And people started getting fascinated by that. And that drew away attention from my expertise to your, not their expertise. That was my picture.
Yeah.
And so I fell into that, exactly in that trap. So I felt too comfortable in my routines. And I thought, okay, this is now how it is. And design management was everybody's darling. And I had quite a nice network. I was respected in that network, or at least I thought. And everything was fine. And then you came and you disrupted that whole thing. And
but we met at a design management institute conference.
Yes, that we can make a podcast on that one conference, and we could include Eric Roskam having on that as well,
and three
perspectives.
Many other people who are still part of that community, because it was the start of a community that has been very influential for me, and I think for many of us.
Yeah, sure.
Because we also, maybe if you think about your, and the way I kind of saw it almost as a symbolical of your character, the blend, you know, the sort of the German Dutchness that you have, sort of you love the chaos and but at the same time you need to structure. Basically, when we met, we represented both of those worlds. Both, you know, things need to be structured. They need to, be patterns, but also
exactly.
we love of chaos. So, the people I met at that design management conference and sort of my introduction to this community has always been very influential, because it also meant that I could blend those worlds, and it was also again a bridge, and you and Eric and others, you know, also kind of were really helpful in creating those bridges and creating those, you know, blending of those communities, the design thinking service design community, and the design management community. So I think we're talking about a transition, moment of transition that we thought was ending with, you know, it was settled for design management, like many people have thought it would settle for service design or design thinking, but I think that we've been discovering that. And again, you know, it's total common sense, but still you have to kind of, when you're in the middle of it, sometimes you don't understand these patterns.
Yes.
But it never settles. It is moving forward. Like, it's moving forward now. Design thinking now is not what it was when we started talking.
And you know what? If I look at it now, I was thinking, Jesus, how blind have I been that I couldn't have seen it? I mean, but that also opens a different topic. But to make it short, it's really because we are talking about patterns, about things that shaped your style of leading, and in hindsight, that also made me sometimes I don't feel this not ashamed for it, I feel ashamed for it that in that very moment I wasn't able to see it. which is now so obvious to see that process, that design thinking is about the process and the likes. And we are so obsessed with the thing, like design, that it wasn't about the notion of what the things are, but what the things should be and all the projections and the likes. That's quite interesting to see. So another advice for the younger generation is don't get too obsessed or too fascinated by yourself and by your topics, and try to remain critical. But
that's not just for younger generations, Ralf.
No. Okay.
That's for all of us, because it's a trap. And we talked about this, when you think about leadership, recognizing patterns, seeing them, and then consciously either using them or disrupting them. But by recognizing patterns, starting with yourself, because as a leader, you have your habits, you have your patterns, you have your part of a system, a wider system, and if you want to change that system, you have to understand patterns. You have to understand how you act within that system, and so I think your ability to reflect is actually to your credit, is nothing to be ashamed of. It's actually amazing to be able to reflect and say, hey, I didn't see it, because there's so many people who still don't see it and will never see it. And that's, that's part of, who they are and where they come from. And there's there's always a reason for everything. But I think to your credit, and also because of your character, because you are always, again, going back and forth from disrupting yourself, and others, and to going back to a pattern, and your comfortable patterns, but also always that. So you are, in that sense, the ideal person to represent basically that transition, and to represent both of these worlds. I, for instance, am mainly chaotic and fuzzy, and I find it very hard to represent the world of structure, and because to me that I really feel uncomfortable there, where I relish and I love the chaotic moments. So I think and maybe that's also the connection that we have, that we represent to a certain extent two different worlds, but we have a connection because we there's something where we come together. Now you are a dean. You're a dean. You're a big guy. You're the hotshot. You're the man. You're the main man at a design school, which to me, when I was young, that was like, you wanted to be an expert manager. But to me, being the dean of a design school is better than an export manager. It's like, that sounds like amazing. Like you reached the top of the top of the top.
Yeah.
Now I know you, and I'm thinking, oh, all right. It's just Ralf. Yeah. Anyway, but
exactly.
So what happened between your consultancy and your becoming the dean of the design school?
Yeah.
Did you go back? Because you have an educational record, because you did already. You went back to university, back to a safe place, maybe.
No, I worked as an independent self-employed consultant, and I was, which was 50%, and the other 50% were working for foreign universities abroad, and developed educational programs in design management and the like. So I had to step in both worlds, so that one, so in academia, at least when you're an external lecturer or something like that, you're not doing it for the money. You do it really to build up a reputation, to build up credibility and the like. So I had to feed that side of my business with my consultancy job. And at a certain point, and it was really that moment where I was, no kidding, I was really standing under the shower in the morning, and once you've turned 30, I mean, the next big step is turning 40. So, which is feeling about really being old. I mean, 40 shit. When you're in your 30s, 40 is really something. Well, but in that shower moment, it was really that where I thought, okay, Ralf, what do you want to have achieved when you turn 40? I mean, at that time, I became a father of a now 20-year-old son, and so I felt responsibility, which is also part of my character. So if it's important for me if I'm in charge that I'm acting responsible, and I refer to that later on. So I was thinking, where do I want to be when I'm 40? So what do I want to have achieved? And having said that, I never really planned my life as we've just agreed. And in hindsight, so I never really deliberately planned the things. I didn't say, now I have to develop a business, or blogs is something, and now I'm blogging. It really emerged. Is my life is very influenced by emerging moments. And so under the shower, I said, I want to become a professor by the latest when I'm 40, because it gave me, it had exactly the job descriptions that were important for me to be independent, but at the same time being in a secure position, because you get a salary. That was, to be honest, that was also one of the criteria. I want to have freedom that I had as a self-employed consultant, but at the same time, the infrastructure, let's not call it the salary. It's the infrastructure around you that gives you the security to do what you want to do and what you're maybe best at. So I thought, that would be, if I would have seen that job description from what the job offers without having the title professor, I would have said, yeah, that's exactly what I want. And if you would have revealed the card, like in a quiz, you've chosen becoming a professor, that would be more the way I've approached to that. So if that would have revealed export manager, maybe I would have tried to apply at companies and become export manager. So in that sense, it was professor. So I thought, okay, that what do you need for that? Yeah, you need to apply for a job. So I looked for job descriptions at universities that offered professorships in design management. And there I applied. And at the second university, which was in Muenster, where I lived by that time, but where I wasn't, to be honest, I wasn't interested in that design school, because at that time it was relatively irrelevant. It was okay, but not a big name. I mean, we are still not a big name. I'm realistic as that. But anyway, at that time it was no man's land. And interestingly enough, at that time I was living 500 meters from that building, but I didn't have it on my radar screen. But then I suddenly saw that they were offering a position, and I applied for that. And to make that long story short, it worked out, but the political decision system turned around at that time, and all new jobs were canceled or were postponed to a later point. And so I got this letter. Yeah, but that process has been stopped, and you were very far in that process, but unfortunately, blah, blah, blah. Okay, so I said, okay, well, sad, but they said, yeah, but you could be an external lecturer, honorary lecturer. And then I said, okay, yeah, because I'm in, yeah, I said, yeah, why not working with a design school? Because my experience was more in design professionals getting a master's degree, a postgraduate master's degree. That was my area of expertise. So I never was in touch with bachelor students. So I thought, yeah, maybe gaining some experience with that is nice. And to make that stream of the story also shorter, that's where the Netherlands again came in. I was at the Design Week in Eindhoven, and I got a call where that former dean called me and said, Ralf, you know what? We can finally offer you a position. at our faculty. And I said, okay, that came really out of nowhere land. Yeah, and when you turn 40, you know that there's always a catch in that whole thing. And I said, yeah, but you need to become a dean. You need to become our dean. And I said, how about to do it the other way around, to come from content and then take over administration? I said, no, we need a dean right now. Literally between that, I said, we're not interested in your content or whatever. But we first now need a dean. And I thought, okay, well, then let's take the challenge. So as I say to my colleagues, because they say, Ralf, you are a dean. You are very good at administration, at orchestration, and the like. So, you need to become, in the next decade, you need to be remain our dean. I said, yeah, but what do you think? Do you think I'm born as a dean? Is that something you plop out of your mother, and then the nurse says, oh, a little dean? No, so no, it doesn't work that way. So one has to develop, fill that role with content. So I accepted that challenge, also because I thought, okay, if that is necessary to my shower experiment, I want to be professor when I'm 40. I thought, okay, if that is now that path that uncovers, I will follow and accept that path. So I said, yeah, I will do that. And then through tiny administration steps, so then I was elected as their dean. And that's now 10 years ago. And if I look back to those recent 10 years and to that, to my main learning experiences, is that, and again, there's that pattern that you've identified, or we've identified collaboratively within this podcast. I discovered that being a dean of a design school is blending chaos in hyphens with order, which is administration. And I'm constantly in this pendulum mode of managing very creative people, like these bunch of professors, illustrators, media designers, product designers, communication designers from all kinds of sub-disciplines, and giving them a structure that still nurtures their creativity and what they are good at, but at the same time makes it manageable for the rest of the organization as on a school level, but also on a university level. So we as a unit and part of that larger system university, we also need to be manageable. So I think I took over with two colleagues that deanship, and we were really the creative clowns. At least that was the image that faculty had. If a wall needs to be painted in fancy colors, ask the designers. They say, no, yellow is not the thing. You need to do it in pink, something like that. And those were the questions and assignments that I overstretch it now. I've been confronted with, and that was very dissatisfying. So first answer was, sorry, I have no clue about colors. Yeah, but you're a designer. No, I'm not a designer. I'm a manager. I studied business administration. Oh, what? You studied business administration, and you now are leading the design faculty. How's that? So that was quite, and I think it still is, but also.
So again, the two worlds are colliding or blending or, you know, and there is this this constant tension between the two sides, which is, you know, most of the time positive energy, but it's, but it can also be, you know, sometimes negative energy.
Oh man, it can be very frustrating. Mm-hmm. It's really, but there was a point, I can't tell you, I can nail it to, okay, now comes something. Now comes, I reveal a secret. Anna, you are not my only friend. You're not my only best friend.
Oh, it's getting worse.
It's getting worse. There is another best friend. So he's a colleague and you know him, it's Rüdiger. And I think he, in hindsight, not in that very moment, it was a struggle. It was a struggle, creativity against structure. It was, while he's a very structured person in a way, but and he's not the typical creative weirdo or whatever. But he made me understand, together also with you, Arne, whisper. That, and you know that phase in my life, which I don't want to talk about now because it would be a different podcast, but where I learned to accept that sometimes you need to let go of structure and of everything.
And just so people know that what we're not going to talk about is the divorce.
No, we don't talk about that, but it made me really learn a lot.
Exactly.
And which nurtured my the way how I see my job right now is to really, sometimes you need to let people go, mm-hmm. not in a way of say goodbye, but give them the freedom, because it's not to tell, and there we are with leaders and what my understanding of leadership is, learn to accept. And that's a very daily struggle I have every morning. I wake up and I subconsciously tell myself, Ralf, really accept and learn, continue learning to accept that the others are not like you, Ralf, and learn to work with others and not accept that they are different individuals. And it's like with this, I'm not good in soccer. I'm not a good analyzer of a soccer match, but soccer tells you a lot of things. And if you are a coach of a soccer team, not in the Premier League, but in the third or fourth league, you need to accept that the team you have. Yeah, it's you need to in life you or in leadership, you need to sometimes learn to accept and work with the team that you have. And that gives you, and you only have two extreme choices. Either you try to make your life hard and impose your view to the world, to the other people, and impose structure to people who have other structures, or you try to identify their structures, accept those structures, and try to see where you can connect to these other structures and craft it as a leadership strategy that works for that organization. And I think maybe, I don't know if that is still valid tomorrow, but maybe I'm not at a moment where I'm satisfied. So I'm not, I don't lean back and say, wow, 10 years mission achieved. And Corona has taught us all that nothing is guaranteed. So, and you need to reinvent. So I don't want to go into that. So that is another podcast for the future. But Corona at least showed me, okay, you are not in safe haven and you need to reinvent yourself. You learn that people are acting so differently under Corona than without it, and they turn out so differently in their behavior where you would have never have expected it. And again, you need to, it's the same soccer team You are still the same coach. The grass is a bit damaged that you have to play now on, and you need to play soccer with these people. And if you're suddenly in, I don't know, in Harlem, New York, where you don't have grass soccer fields, but concrete soccer field, then suddenly you need to, okay, we have a concrete soccer field right now. Then you have to learn that the ball on that soccer field is acting differently. So
you're saying leadership is about understanding structures, seeing them, not being able to always change them to the structures that you want or the way you see it. But you have to accept other people's structures or the way they do things by then basically designing or crafting your strategy. However,
yes.
But things change. So it means that also accepting the chaos of, in this case, Corona. So being able to, again, recognizing changing patterns and then bringing them back to some kind of strategy and some kind of, you know, things, process that people can understand, which is obviously, again, a skill going back, you know, going this back and forth from being comfortable with chaos, but really also wanting to have structure. Yeah. So,
but may I interrupt you again?
Yes, of course.
Because I know I'm the mode of the takeaways for the listeners. No, but actually, what a pattern we haven't talked about, and maybe we don't need to, because dive deep into it is as a reflection why I. And you can't do that alone. So that's maybe where we also started with humor and the like. So humor only works when there are two people at least in the room. I mean, I'm having fun with myself and tell myself a joke and I can giggle. I mean, everyone has that, but usually it's far more fun if you make a joke and the other one clicks to it and the likes. And by the same way, leadership is something you need to have people where it really works, where you can trust, where you have no plan and you can only trust with the situation or with the fact that I will meet that person in 1 hour and let's see what gets out of it. And I think one has to accept that this is not randomness or unprofessionalism or whatever. And that's what our biographic stories is about. So I really had to learn, and I'm still struggling with it, to accept it. So I was raised like going into a meeting without a clear strategy, only relying on the fact that I know that there are, from the 10 people, there are two or three in the room. I know that I can trust and connect with, and I can trust that something good will emerge from that, whatever that might be. My parents, not in person, but my parents would have said, Jesus, Ralf, that is really unprofessional. You are charging, when I was self-employed, you are charging companies for that skill. Whoa, take care that they, imposter syndrome, another podcast, from the imposter syndrome thingy, Ralf, one day somebody will discover that you are completely unskilled, and then they will nail you on the wall. Nowadays, I still have it. Okay, I'm getting a salary. Ralf, do you really think you deserve that salary for that skill, going into a meeting unprepared, only relying that the two people that you have good sense of humor with will work out? And yes, it will work out. So advice. Look for people in your team, in your organization, and that you connect with, not only on a professional level, but also on a human side level, and see how you can work with that. Not to exploit that, but to work with that. And maybe I had the luck to meet, I think you can count them on one hand, to meet these people that I know that I can connect with. And even among these people are also people that I'm not currently in contact with, at where through different various reasons. But I still do know that if I'm in the room with these people, something good will come out of it. And to rely and trust on that, and to learn that, to trust people, I think that's something very important, which condensed inside is leadership is nothing that has a leader and people who are being led. I think it is, and I say that as a I'm and that goes to the character. I'm a swimmer. I'm a triathlete. I'm a jogger. I'm a cyclist. I'm really bad with sports that deal with other people. All sports that deal with balls, I'm so bad with them, because I'm, to be honest, from my inner nature, I'm not a team player. From that part, I'm not. Interestingly, I'm not a team player. I can perform best when I'm alone in the pool, and that's where I because it only depends on me. In a triathlon, it depends a little bit on the bike that you drive and on the running shoes that you wear, but unless I'm only reliable on me and I can only trust me. On the other hand, I learned that ambivalence between individualistic, single, and having to learn to become a team player. And I think leadership does not work without a good team. And to be honest, when that one friend will leave our faculty because of retirement regulations, I think I need to reinvent myself, because I'm losing a counterpart on that, which I could have insight. I could have never performed the way I have performed in the past and also nowadays without the people who are with me. And that's why it's always so nice, even though you roll your eyes in the boot camps, when I do my lectures there, and you've heard these stories 1,000 times, but it works. And it works with some other people as well. There are not so many, but in leadership, form teams where that are balanced in that way.
And for people who don't know us and don't know the boot camps that we run together with our team from the Design Thinkers Academy.
Yeah, exactly.
I don't really roll my eyes. So.
Is that an app you always?
No, I don't really roll my eyes. I don't do that. I do it inside of me. So, but I don't really physically don't do that. Okay. Last thing I wanted to say or wanted to ask.
My battery is running low. It says only 16%.
There you go. So
there's a physical limit to it.
Yeah, there's a physical limit. So because I keep thinking about the kid primary school being the sort of the clown making the jokes, but at the same time not being connecting, not having the connection to the other kids. Now basically you go back to school, is that kid still there?
Yeah, sure. Sure it is. Mm-hmm. For two reasons. And for one very specific reason, it's in the nature of working at a university. And I think every teacher, let it be primary school or higher education teacher, that's the fate and destiny of a teacher. You get older. You get an old fart at a certain point while your pupils always fucking stay young. It's an offense. It's a constant offense. Really, these young kids are an offense to the job description. And again, if you don't accept that this is, and to be honest, I'm struggling with it. It's to connect, because when you're 30 and you're working as a teacher, as a university lecturer, the bonding is still there because the students are 5 years younger than you are, something like that. When you turn 40, then it's 10 years, but okay, you can still wear sneakers and things like that and wear a Nike t-shirt, then you connect to them as well. So then, okay, accept it. Then 40, then you turn 50. Jesus, that is really, really old. And this is where, for most of us, some clothes as a symbol for things, some clothes really don't work anymore. And we all fall into the trap that we subtly dress awkwardly, where they look at you and you feel that, and you feel, okay, you need to change something, not only with the clothes, with a superficial level, but also with your mindset. So accepting things and the likes. And the question with that kid is, yeah, it's sure. Every lecture, every new semester, every boot camp, every public speaking in public is and remains a challenge. I'm nervous. I have my doubts. And the smaller the group is, the more serious it gets. So I think I remember where I was the moderator of the Brown Design Prize. So many years back, and the forum at the Brown for that time, that was where Dieter Rams touched things, right? It's where they now put it in a glass box. So the pen Dieter Rams touched. No, it's not like that at Brown, but still the forum was filled with 1,000 people for that prize ceremony. The head of Procter & Gamble was there because he was a former US general. The security, the NSA, whatever people were there. And I was, to be honest, I was not really nervous for a second, but then it went away. But the very moment I'm going to smaller meetings, it's still there. And then the challenge is, yes, sure you do, by turning older, you do some jokes, and there we are at the starting point with, you do some jokes that work, and I know which jokes usually work. But then again, it's a constant exploration of what works beyond that. And I think that's the really nice challenge. And I think I'm in a process of learning to accept that this will never be stable. So it will remain chaotic. It will require from my end that I need to adjust myself to that context constantly. And talking about the boot camps, the design thinking boot camps, and the people attending it, they also changed over time. It's quite interesting to see that in the beginning it were a lot of designers attending them. And now it's really far more managers, even, okay, nobody listens to us, accountants. So, but that's more referral to Monty Python jokes about accountants, but bracket closed. So it's interesting who attends to them, and they think they work differently. And sometimes it's quite irritating, also known as interesting, to see how people behave in that context. I don't want to judge about it, but it's a new learning experience to see, okay, this is what triggers people and this is what they find interesting. Okay, accept that and see how that works with you. But the question is, the inner child is still there, and I do think it will not go away. I think while having talked about it now for more than 1 hour, I think it will become a little bit milder, that effect. But then again, we are again at that point where what we've said half an hour ago, don't become spießig, self satisfactory, is being too satisfied with yourself. And
I don't think you have that in your you to become speedy. So I think you are you will be always on that search for balance, going back and forth. And I think that's wonderful, and I enjoy that, and I really want to thank you for having this conversation and yes. sharing this story with me and the rest of the world.
Did I tell you something new? Maybe I cannot.
No.
No.
Yes.
To be honest. No.
Yes, no, you Ralf. Did. No. It's like you said. It is reflection and connecting things that are, you know, I know from because I know you for a long time. So, but the being able to connect things in a story sometimes creates, you know, recognizing patterns and mm-hmm. saying, hey, yeah. and I want people to understand that if you look at, you know, your heroes or the people who are your examples or the people who you feel like they have all made or whatever, mm-hmm. you know, they're very successful, you know, the people you look up to, these are not the people you can copy. You can't copy them. You can't say, I want to be exactly like them, because like your story, like everyone's story, is filled with coincidences. It's filled with, you know, you came from a place, you grew up in a way, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You have your, you know, you took the DNA from your parents. So you everything that made you made you very unique to everyone else. And your perception and your perspective and your worldview and your reality is different than everyone else's.
Yes,
so sure. I just want to say, and I hope it feels to people as a liberation to kind of say, no, you don't look at others. You don't find the answer in others. You might find inspiration and courage, but you find it in yourself. There is no other way, because you can never be Ralf, mm-hmm. because that is impossible.
Even I cannot be me.
Yeah. Well, that's a good ending for the podcast, I think, which Ralf cannot be Ralf.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Ralf.
You're welcome.